now watching Way Back Wednesday, sponsored by Davenport Auto Park, the ride of your life. And also sponsored by Flora's Glass, serving the area since 1977 with residential and commercial work.
Friends, and welcome to another episode of Way Back Wednesday. I'm Randy Adcox. Things have been a bit hectic around here this evening, so I do apologize for running a few minutes late. That's my fault. I was late getting here tonight. Got held up on the telephone, and anyway, we're here. We're here. We're on the show. We're live. Today is Wednesday, June the 29th. If you're watching at any other time, you're watching a replay. But we'd love to hear from you tonight. You know the number, 407-1111 there on your screen. We're going to show you some pictures tonight, obviously, and we're going to talk a little bit about a topic we touched on last week quite a bit. We're going to go back and revisit it tonight a little bit, and that's Silver Lake and the area surrounding Silver Lake. You know, I had a nice phone chat after last week's show with Wallace Abernathy, and as many of you know, Wallace is a historian in his own right. He's got a lot of history of Eastern North Carolina in particular. But he called me, and we had a real nice conversation about some history that I was not aware of around the area, around, well, not exactly at Silver Lake, but, you know, the Toys Not Swamp is something many of you are familiar with. I didn't realize that it was as broad as it is and covers as much territory as it does. The watershed for Toys Not Swamp is, I forgot how many square miles, but it's a fairly big footprint. And so anyway, it runs almost up to, well, parts of Nash County, obviously, and down through Wilson County, almost down to Snow Hill, I think it is. But there's an awful lot of history in that footprint of Toys Not Swamp, not including, of course, the history at Silver Lake. But one of the things that that Wallace brought to my attention was that in the 1700s, there was actually, they mined for iron there at the Toys Not Swamp. And It was in use for many years. I found a couple of articles that I wanted to share with you, and we'll get into those in just a minute. But Lee, if you would, let's put up that very first item number one there. This is a map, and this is from 1892. And I know it's kind of hard to see on your screen, but at the very top, just about dead center, there's Rocky Mount. A little to the left of that, of course, is Nashville. If you follow that dark line in the middle of your screen, it rides down to Wilson. I guess that's probably fairly close to present-day 301. Obviously, there was no 301 in 1892, but you get the idea. That's the general path between Rocky Mount and Wilson. And all the little squirrely lines you see there, particularly between Wilson and Rocky Mount, all of that is kind of part of, or at least a watershed for Toys Not Swamp. And it's amazing how much there is to that watershed, and there's creeks that flow into it. You know, if you spend any time at all in Wilson, particularly if you come in off of 301 and turn there, I think it's Highway 42, and go into Wilson that way, you'll go past an area where there's a big, what I call a big ditch there. And when Wilson was being developed many, many years ago, and not only Wilson, we'll talk a little bit about Elm City and other areas. There was just a lot of different parts of little creeks and estuaries and streams that were part of the Toys Not Swamp watershed. And so there's part of it's been, you know, enclosed in culverts and piping and so forth, and roads built over it. But there's still an awful lot of that swamp area all over southern Nash County, northern Wilson County, and and they were aware of it. The point of this map is in 1892, a lot of it had been surveyed, and they had already figured out there's an awful lot of water there, an awful lot of streams, and of course, you see the Tar River up there. But it's all kind of comes together. And so anyway, I just wanted to share that with you first of all. That's from 1892, that map. Okay, so Lee, if you would, put up the next item, item number two there. And this is a map showing basically, you see right in the middle of your screen there, that's I-95, and to the left of that is what's commonly called the Old Bailey Highway or Lamb Road. And there was, when they were mining this ore back in the early 1700s, I learned something I didn't know, that the word or phrase bloomery, not to be confused with bloomers, a bloomery is basically a place where they process iron ore. And there was actually this a longest path here, not too far from what I understand, it's Horn's Church, I think it is, there was a bloomery. And so it was operational in the late 1700s. And you know, and prior to that, you got to think about what was going on in the late 1700s. There was anything that was made out of iron had to be shipped in here from either, you know, England or up north somewhere. And so when they discovered that there was iron ore in the ground around here in this part of the state, and by the way, when I was researching for tonight's show, I did not realize just how widespread the iron ore is in the state of North Carolina. It's almost in every county in varying degrees and varying qualities. It's not all the same, obviously. But there's an awful lot of iron ore in the state of North Carolina, in the state of North Carolina. And so when it was discovered and they found that they could actually mine this stuff in the 1700s, it was a big thing because they didn't have to import iron anymore. They could make their process their own. They, you know, got to dig the ore out of the ground and melt it down and turn it into pots and pans and tools and farm implements and all kind of things. And it was all processed right here in eastern North Carolina, right here in Nash and Wilson counties. So anyway, one of the things that was done was there were some railroad tracks made, and it was used to, you know, bring the ore in to the processing plant and then ship it out again as, you know, as need be. And Lee, item number three, if you would put that up, this is actually a piece of railroad tie. And if you look at it, you can see the hammering there. I don't know exactly how old this is. My guess is early 1800s. But it was way, way before they were processing railroad ties like they do now. And you see it was hammered out there. You still see the hammer marks in it. And another interesting little tidbit, there was I found an article that made a reference to a cannonball, a Civil War cannonball. During the war, of course, by the way, this thing was operated, this bloomery was in operation during the First World War, and then it was also operational in the Civil War. And there was a period of time when it would shut down, would open back up again. But during the Civil War, they made cannonballs there, and they were shipped out on rail cars to Richmond and other parts for the war effort. And so there was just an awful lot. And even after the war was over with and they shut the plant down, it opened back up again a couple times, I think it was. But I wanted to read a couple things to you here that just kind of, and by the way, Lee, you can go ahead and go to that very next one because this is another section of the same railroad track, I think it is. I think it's a cross section, but it kind of is another view. There you go. Again, you can see the hammering that was done to form this railroad section, this piece of railroad section up. Railroad rail, I guess, is the proper. I think I said tie earlier. It's obviously the railing. But anyway, I want to read a couple things to you. And Wallace had sent me some really neat information and articles here, and so I want to share some of that with you too. But one of the things that I ran across that I thought was really interesting was the story of Elm City. And you know, I heard the term "Toys Not Swamp" literally all my life, and even though I didn't spend a lot of time in Wilson as a kid, went through there many times traveling and different things. And so certainly I was familiar with Elm City. But this article actually appeared in June of 2016. And this was actually a publication, and I've forgotten now what it was. But anyway, I'll read a little bit of this to you. This fellow who wrote this says, "I wrote the news page Life in Elm City in April 1991. When I began the monthly feature page earlier, I had devised a sort of formula for what the pages would contain, a news story, feature piece, and a 5 or 10 item sidebar I called historical note. For the Elm City news piece, I discussed growth issues, including plans to reuse the inactive depot. For a feature, I profiled a family's produce business. A photographer illustrated both stories." And he goes on to talk about, you know, researching Elm City and so forth. And then he gets to actually naming. He says, "The naming of any town can be a delicate proposition. That is especially true of the naming of Elm City in Wilson, North Carolina." Wilson County, North Carolina. "The community's origin name was Toys Not, pronounced Toss Not." He's got it here, T-O-S-S-N-O-T, like Toss Not. "Believed derived from the Tuscarora Indian word, Tarry Not, or from the Tuscarora in town, Toisinnock. That's near where the Toisinnock Swamp and Buck Branch converge. The town was chartered by the state legislature as Toisinnock in 1873. So Elm City was originally called Toisinnock. In 1891, it became Elm City, but in 1895, it resumed operations as Toisinnock. In 1913, it took back the name Elm City. And he goes on to talk about Joiner's Depot, which is a mile north of present-day Elm City, beside the Wilmington Weldon Railroad, built in 1839. The depot operated officially from 1846 to 1873. Nearby residents wanted to buy land for the street construction, but area farmers balked and wouldn't sell. So area residents moved to what is present-day Elm City, and the Elm City Post Office succeeded the one at Joiner's Depot. So how about that? Elm City was actually originally a little bit further south than where it is now, and people wanted to build houses and live there, and the farmers on the land wouldn't sell the land, so the people just up and moved the whole town a little bit further north and built the city of Elm City. So anyway, I thought it was neat that Elm City was originally named Toisinnock. Now I mentioned that there was a couple of articles that Wallace had sent me, and one of them was, I think this is the right one here, forgive me if I've got the wrong one, it's called The Connector. And it tells a story. It says, in the early days, settlers either bought farm and household implements imported from England, or they made them themselves. Since English goods were expensive and in short supply, it must have been a happy day when iron ore was discovered in a large clay hill along the southern banks of Toisinnock Swamp in eastern North Carolina near Horns Church Community. Ore was mined, refined, and made into utensils and tools about 1779 by the Bloomery Company on land leased from Thomas Horn Jr. And it goes on to tell about, you know, what they did at the Bloomery and what kind of utensils they made. And I found a neat article too that actually tells the story of the Bloomery Company. In fact, I'll tell you what, Lee, let's go ahead. I kind of got ahead of myself there. Are you on item number 5 here?
Yeah.
Okay. This is an overhead view, aerial view of the general area where the Bloomery was. You see Lamb Road to your right, and you see the Bloomery Swamp there. And of course, this is all still part of the Toisinnock watershed. And there's no trace of this, by the way, left anymore. There's nothing. They said a lot of this stuff was buried after the war and after, you know, ceased to be in use. I'm not sure when the last operation was, anything was done here. I think it might have been in the 30s or 40s, but anyway, now everything is long gone. But in 1971 or 2, I think it was, a farmer was actually out in his field farming or planting or plowing the land or something and stumbled across a cannonball. And it was after much debate and much research, it was believed to be a Civil War cannonball. And this article appeared in, actually last year, fall of 2021, in Wilson's Heritage, a little newsletter of the Wilson County Historical Association. And by the way, this is something I think is really neat. Wilson has got a Wilson County Historical Association, and I'm not sure how often this is published. The one I've got in my hand is Volume 10, Number 4, from fall of 2021. But it talks about when this cannonball was discovered. And I read a little bit of this. I don't want to get too involved here because it's kind of a long article. But it talks about, you know, the different things that were made there during the Civil War and how it was, you know, used to produce iron product and so forth. And it also says, in recent years, cannonball fragments and a cannonball were discovered in the Bloomery Swamp area. One of those discoveries occurred when Russell James Thompson, a Nash County native, was harvesting a fall crop in the late 1970s. He was contracted to harvest soybeans on the land of Reese and Lizzie Williams in the Jackson Township. It says he was operating a four-row gleaner Model G combine when a loud noise came from the combine, resulting in it coming to a sudden stop. Upon inspection, he discovered the combine had unearthed a cannonball, which caused significant damage to the combine. The cannonball soon remained a topic of conversation. The location of the cannonball was in a field on the west side of Old Bailey Road, approximately 7/10 of a mile north of the West Horns Church Road. And so I did not find a picture of the ball, but there were some pretty good specs out there on the cannonballs used by the Confederacy and those used by the Union troops. And so after much discussion and much measuring, they were able to determine that it was indeed a Civil War cannonball. Never fired, obviously, but it was buried after the bloomery ceased to operate down there after the Civil War, and this farmer uncovered it when he was harvesting his crops somewhere in 1970. So a little bit of neat history there about that area. Go ahead, Lee, if you would, to the next item, item number five, I think it is. That was five, I'm sorry, item number six. And I think this is just an aerial view again. You see the little curvy lines there, they're identified as branch of Toys Not Swamp. And this is from the 1940s, actually, this picture here. And I read an article, and I forgot now where it was at. It was interesting. It was a historical narrative about someone who was born and raised in Wilson and knew a little bit about the history of Wilson and told the story as a child of playing in what they refer to as these big ditches, not knowing at the time that they were part of the Toys Not Swamp. And so from this aerial view from the 1940s, you can actually see those little curly lines that are going through all through Wilson were actually these big ditches that these kids were talking about. Later years, they realized, of course, they were part of the Toys Not Swamp. So anyway, let's go ahead and lead to the next one, just an aerial view, a more modern day view. There you go. And you can still see on the aerial view, you see where it says branch of Toys Not Swamp there. That little greenish area there that's crossing over Highway 264 to your left of your screen there, which is, of course, modern-day Ward Boulevard down below, and you see Highway 301 in the far right-hand corner of your screen down there, in the bottom right-hand corner. But these branches, these streams, these parts of Toys Not Swamp exist all over Wilson County, and southern Nash County, and during heavy rains and floods like we had during the hurricane and so forth in years past, these things still do flood and cause problems. Anyway, okay, so I'll tell you what, Lee, bring it back to me. I know we got started a little bit late, but I want to try to get back on track. I just realized I went past our first commercial break. So we'll go ahead and have a quick commercial break. When we come back, we're going to talk a little bit more about the bloomery and just a few minutes on that. And then I've got some neat, interesting history on Wiggins Lake. I thought we'd look at Wiggins Lake tonight, too. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with more Way Back Wednesday.
I'm Daniel Moss, owner of Cornerstone Funeral Home, and I'd like to invite you and your family to give our family an opportunity to serve you in your time of need. And we offer a full line of funeral services, everything from visitations to graveside services to cremations on site with a live crematory, as well as a banquet hall to meet the catering needs of our families that we serve. We offer catering service. We offer refreshments prior to visitation and services of our family. And we want to invite you to come and experience the difference here at Cornerstone Funeral Home.
Hello, my name is Gus Tullis of Gus Tullis Insurance, and I've been helping people with their insurance needs for well over 20 years. If you're turning 65 or you're currently on Medicare, I can help you make the best decision for the Medicare plan that will suit your needs. Don't wait. Call me today. I'll answer any question you have. 252-937-6913. Looking forward to hearing from you.
When faced with special care needs for elderly or disabled loved ones, families want compassionate, comforting care. That's Tender Touch Home Care Services' goal, providing the level of care we would expect for our own. With over 10 years of home care excellence, Tender Touch provides an array of services that keeps your loved one at home. From personal care, light housekeeping, errands, and meal preparation, to our private duty care program, which combines all of our home care offerings in one package.
Tender Touch Home Care Services, where your needs are our concern.
We're back. We're talking a little bit tonight about Toys Not Swamp and the area around Silver Lake and Lake Wilson. And there's a lot of history there that, frankly, I was not aware of. I'm sure many of you may not be aware of it either. Some of you, I'm sure, are. But the point being that there was iron ore discovered there in the 1700s, and it became a significant part of the development of the Wilson County, southern Nass County area, particularly in the late 1700s and even to the 1800s, because it was such a rare commodity. You know, instead of having to ship iron ore and iron products in here, when they found this ore, they could make their own, and that just made things much easier for the locals here. I mentioned earlier there was a company called the Bloomery Company. And a little history here. This is a long article. I'm just going to read the first couple paragraphs of it. But it says, on March 1st of 1779, Thomas Horn Jr. of Nass County made a deed of agreement with the Bloomery Company, who had erected a bloomery on the swamp known as Great Swamp at that time, granting them the privilege to dig and make use of all the iron ore on his land for 2.6 pounds hard money, or for iron at 6 pence per pound for every hundredweight that the said bloomery made out of the ore. There was a couple of witnesses, of course, to this agreement. And then a few years later, October of 1783, Edward Moore was granted by Governor Alexander Martin a tract of 640 acres on Great Swamp, including the bloomery. And it goes on to talk about, you know, by this time the thing was up in operation. They were producing a fair amount of iron ore and of course, iron product and so forth. But, you know, this was, again, late 1700s when all this was taking place. So I think we might have one or two more, one more picture lead. But did we ever get to picture number 9 a while ago? I think it's actually an article. Oh, that was it. Okay. All right. Go ahead and put it up there. That's the one I was just reading. I think it's just that article. That's 8 right there, right? Okay, here we go. I forgot we had this in here. This article here appeared actually in, this is which number, Lee, 8 you saying?
8.
Okay, this appeared in the Rocky Mount Telegram in 1951, and it tells the story of the old iron mine in Nass County, and you see there the headline, Old Iron Mine, Rich in History, and it talks about, you know, how all this came together. It's a very interesting article, it was obviously it's fairly long there, so I didn't want to read the whole thing. But if anyone is interested, I actually do have this article. I didn't bring it other than the picture tonight to share with you. But it's a lot of history there, a lot of interesting information about that area. And, you know, it reminded me, too, when we first moved, we live out in the Dorchers area, and when we first moved to the house we're in now, there was a well there, of course, and every time we'd get a heavy rain, our well water would just turn really, really dark brown, almost muddy looking. And thought we had a problem with the well, frankly. And I had a certified soil scientist to come out and look at our property and take some soil samples. And he told me, he said, you know, he said, there's a lot of iron in your ground out here, in the soil around your home. And what's happening is, on these heavy rains, the iron is leaching out of the ground and it's ending up in your well. And my first thought was, well, my well at the time is like 85 feet deep. I had to replace the pump one time. That's how I know. When we pulled the old well out, we had to measure it to make sure we had a long enough water pipe to put a new pump back in the bottom of the well. So it was 85 feet deep. I said, surely rainwater is not going to leach through 85 feet of dirt and contaminate my well. And what he told me was that probably somewhere in fairly close proximity to my house, there's some kind of crevice or crack or cave or something where groundwater is able to get down far enough to get into the water table. So long story short, even here right around the Dorchers, Red Oak, Nashville area, there's a lot of iron ore in the ground. We have since migrated over to county water, and it doesn't taste as good as the old well water does, obviously, but I don't have to hear the wife complain about brown water anymore, so it was worth it to do the switch over. So anyway, I did get ahead of myself. Go ahead, Lee. That was picture number 8. Picture number 9 is actually the article I was talking about a minute ago. You can go ahead and, there you go. You can go ahead and go past that one. I mentioned Wiggins Lake. When I saw the articles about Silver Lake and all that was going on there back in the 30s, 40s, 50s, and so forth, I said, well, you know, I remember as a child going to Wiggins Lake, and we went swimming, obviously, and fishing too. I went with my grandparents fishing there a time or two. But I did not realize that the same types of events that were taking place out at Silver Lake over the many, many decades were also taking place out at Wiggins Lake to some degree. Wiggins Lake, I don't think, is as big as Silver Lake. It's been a long, long time since I've been out there, and now I want to go back. I just want to ride out there and take a look at the lake. But when I was doing research for the night show, I started looking at newspaper clippings, and this one you see on your screen here is from 1958, and you see it says, enjoy fishing, swimming at Wiggins Lake, bathhouses, restrooms, pavilion, open every day, Wiggins Lake, and you see the proprietor, Mr. J.L. Wiggins. I did see an article, too, that said Mr. Wiggins actually, I don't know if he created the lake or dammed a stream up to make the lake or how it came to be, but whatever it was done in the 1940s. And I looked to see if I could find any reference to any activity or anything going back that far and didn't find anything, at least nothing in print. There very well could have been all kind of events going on out there, swimming, fishing, boating, etc. But this was the first reference I found to any activity, and it was from August of 1958. So the very next year, if you would, go ahead, let's go to picture number 11. In July of 1959, I found this article or this ad, and it's not the greatest picture quality, but it's one of the few pictures I've ever seen of Wiggins Lake at the height of its popularity. And this was from, again, 1959, July 59. You see the headline there, beat the heat at Wiggins Lake, 7 miles from Rocky Mount near the test farm. And you see the beach there. And this is kind of what I remember as a small child. We went out there, like I said, went swimming a couple times, went fishing, I think, too. But there was a platform. You could swim out there and dive off the platform. There was a diving board out there. And, of course, the nice little sandy beach. And I apologize again. This is not a great picture. This was from the Rocky Mount Telegram. And it wasn't a very good quality picture when I pulled it up on my computer screen. And when I saved it, it didn't do it any favors. So. But it kind of gives you a glimpse of what, as you can see from the picture, a lot of people were out there. In the middle of the summer, this was their time of the year, and they had a little concession stand out there, too, and sold knickknacks and drinks and so forth. And so it was a popular place to be. A lot of people spent a lot of time out there in the summertime. By 1961, Lee, go ahead and put the next one up there, I ran across this ad here. And this one, actually, if I remember correctly, can we get that next one up, Lee? There you go. And you can zoom back out. This is the first reference I saw. I saw a bunch of ads, by the way, from 1958 to 1961. But this was the first one I saw that advertised dancing. So not only was there fishing and swimming and picnicking, there was dancing. There was a lifeguard on duty. And you see the directions there, out Pine Tops Highway, turn left at West Edgecombe School. So, popular place, obviously, lots of activities for young and old alike. And, you know, I don't know when the dancing and that kind of activity ceased to be at Wiggins Lake. In later years, I think it reverted more to a private property type lake. I know someone who lives out there now. I didn't realize until earlier this evening that I actually do know a resident out there. So I'm going to try to make contact with that person and see if I can get an invitation to go out there and do a little fishing, maybe explore a little bit. But anyway, by 1969, I guess Mr. Wiggins was up in age by this time. Like I said, the story I read was that he started all this in the 1940s. By 1969, I guess he'd had enough and probably ready to retire. I'm not even sure he was still living. In all candor, he may have been passed on and his family decided to get rid of the property or sell the property. So, Lee, picture number 13, if you would, is just an advertisement that I found where they put the Wiggins Lake property up for sale. And as you can see, at that time, there were 16 trailer homes included, a boathouse, swimming facilities, fishing, and you see there a 60-acre lake. If memory serves me, I think Silver Lake was about 125 acres or so. So this is about half the size of Silver Lake. So nowhere near the same, you know, size of lake in property. But it was a lot of people went out there, particularly people who live in that Edgecombe County and out in that area. Only half the property was developed, and made $22,000 gross income in 1969. So, you know, that would be a bargain for sure by today's numbers. But in any case, I'm not sure. I did run across another article that listed another owner sometime later. But I'll tell you what, Lee, let's go ahead then to the next picture. That was number 13, I believe. Okay, so number 14, I had a chuckle reading this article, and I'm going to read a little bit of this for you because I know you can't see much more than the headline here. But this tells the story of a young fellow who was out on Wiggins Lake on a boat, and this occurred in July of 1970. And apparently he got pulled or somehow interrupted in his boating by, I guess it was, been a game warden, and accused of not having enough life preservers on the boat for the number of people on the boat. So he decided to go to court. He pleaded his case to the officer, was to no avail, and decided to take the case to court. And he was too young to represent himself, and so he and his father decided that his father would represent his son as an attorney, even though he was not an attorney himself. And so I won't mention the man's name. He may be related to some of you, so I don't want to embarrass anybody. But it says the young fellow, they went to court, and it says the trial went into deep detail, with the defense claiming to have enough life-preserving equipment on board. The younger fellow pointed out that of the three people in the boat, they had one standard life preserver, one cushion preserver, and an empty gas tank. The defense argued that the empty gas tank can, in the case of an emergency, be used as a life preserver. It was more than an hour into the trial when the father was found in contempt. He made a remark to his son, which was overheard by the judge. Upon being asked by the judge to repeat the statement, the father said, "This whole court has seemed a little kangaroo to me." At that, the father was fined $10 for contempt of court and sent to jail. And spent an hour in jail for calling the court a kangaroo court. As it so happens, I knew the son. I never knew the father. I knew the son and never heard this story before. And just goes to show, I think the old saying is, a man who represents himself in the court has got a fool for an attorney or whatever. It didn't work out too well in this case anyway. So. That was in 1970. In 1973, I ran across a picture of a gentleman who caught a couple of nice bass. And as it turns out, there have been some really nice fish caught in Wiggins Lake over the years. I saw several pictures, in fact, of some really trophy-sized bass. In fact, Lee, if you would go ahead and put up picture number 15, I think it is. There you go. And this is Mr. Jackie Pierce. Says he hoisted a pair of nice bass he caught last weekend at Wiggins Lake. The two weighed a total of 10 pounds, not trophies obviously, but good-sized fish. And they were caught, it says, on spring lizards, whatever that must be, artificial bait. And it says Wiggins Lake operator Randolph Whitley reports that a number of bass broke fishermen's lines over the weekend, with several other large fish were landed. So by 1973, it had been sold, of course. The Wiggins family was no longer in ownership of the property. It looks like Mr. Randolph Whitley was the lake operator at the time. It doesn't say he's the owner. It refers to him as the lake operator, so I'm not sure whether he owned the lake or was just someone hired to, you know, run the business, so to speak. But that was in 1973. Tell you what, Lee, we've got two more in this category, so we'll go ahead and put those up right now. These are both fairly recent pictures of Wiggins Lake as it appears today. You see, that's the old, what's left of the old dock out there in the middle of water. People would swim out there and then dive off the dock into the water. And you see in the foreground, the very bottom of the screen, a little bit of the sandy beach. And I'm not sure when this picture was taken. I did not have a date. I actually found this online. I think it might have been on the... Wiggins Lake has a Facebook page, by the way, and I think that's where I found this picture. And then lastly, the last picture is just another picture. It shows a little more angle. And you see by now the sandy beach is pretty much gone. It's grassed over. You still see the remnants of the dock out there, the platform, I should say, where people swim out. The caption of this picture is said, made a mention of All that's left is the platform and the supports for the diving board. So I'm not sure exactly from this angle where the diving board was, but pretty little lake, not very big, obviously, compared to Silver Lake, but still a hot spot for a lot of people. A lot of fun times took place there over the years. I'll tell you what, Lee, bring it back to me. We're just in time for our next commercial break. Someone, and I don't want to misstate this, so I won't try to call a name. I can only say that someone sent the station a package with, oh God, it must be 300 or 400 pictures in it. And the only thing I can figure, just looking at the back of the pictures, because they were all taken about the same time, someone rode around with, I guess, a pocket Instamatic camera back in 1988 and took pictures of all kinds of businesses around Rocky Mount, everything from grocery stores to restaurants. Some of these businesses are long gone, gone forever, I'm afraid to say. But Sandra called me and asked me would I come look at them and would I share them on the show, and I said, sure, of course. So I took them back to my office and I began scanning these things. I ended up scanning about 150, which is not even half of all the ones that are there. So when we come back to from the break, I'll show you some of these pictures of these old grocery stores. Tonight we're going to show grocery stores, but I broke them into several categories, grocery stores and restaurants and so forth. And you'll kind of get the gist as we go along over the next two or three weeks. I'll share some of these each week. But Lee, let's go ahead and take it to a commercial break. When we come back, we'll look at some old Rocky Mount grocery stores. Don't go anywhere, folks. We'll be right back.
Daniel Moss, owner of Cornerstone Funeral Home, and I'd like to invite you and your family to give our family an opportunity to serve you in your time of need. And we offer a full line of funeral services, everything from visitations to graveside services to cremations on site with a live crematory, as well as a banquet hall to meet the catering needs of our families that we serve. We offer catering service, we offer refreshments prior to visitations and services of our family, and we want to invite you to come and experience the difference here at Cornerstone Funeral Home.
Hello, my name is Gus Tullis of Gus Tullis Insurance, and I've been helping people with their insurance needs for well over 20 years. If you're turning 65 or you're currently on Medicare, I can help you make the best decision for the Medicare plan that will suit your needs. Don't wait. Call me today. I'll answer any question you have. 252-937-6913. Looking forward to hearing from you.
When faced with special care needs for elderly or disabled loved ones, families want compassionate, comforting care. That's Tender Touch Home Care Services' goal, providing the level of care we would expect for our own. With over 10 years of home care excellence, Tender Touch provides an array of services that keeps your loved one at home. From personal care, light housekeeping, errands, and meal preparation, to our private duty care program, which combines all of our home care offerings in one package.
Tender Touch Home Care Services, where your needs are our concern.
And we're back. We're back. You know, before the break, we were talking about someone sent us some pictures. And like I said, I'm not exactly sure who took the pictures. I'm not exactly sure who brought them. But someone brought an envelope full of pictures to the station. And so Sandra called me last week and asked me would I be interested in taking these pictures and sharing them on the show. And I said, of course, I'd love to. Some really neat pictures in that envelope. Most of them are little 3x5, I guess, Instamatic type. They were taken back in the 80s, so maybe a Polaroid. I'm not even sure what camera took them. But some of them are kind of grainy, some are not great quality, but most of them are actually very good quality. So anyway, I went through and started scanning these things. I've got a digital scanner at my desk in my office, and so I took pictures one by one, put them in a scan and scan them, and then The ones that I could identify, and a few, not many, but a few actually had the identity of the building or the store on the back of the picture, which was a big help, obviously. So I went through the ones that I could personally identify and all the ones that were already identified from the back of the picture, included those first. So what we're looking at tonight is the first grouping of grocery stores. And you know, you've heard me use the term areas of commerce many times on this show, and we've talked about that all over Rocky Mount, all over this part of the state. In fact, little communities sprang up where there would be, you know, a couple of businesses, maybe a gas station, always a little some kind of convenience store or country store, whatever. And they were a lifeline for the local residents in those communities. You could walk to the store, for example, and get a loaf of bread or a drink or a gallon of milk. You could walk to the store and get a can of gas for your lawnmower if you needed to. So these little areas of commerce were critically important, particularly in the rural areas, more so in rural areas, but even in the city, back when people didn't all have a vehicle and couldn't drive everywhere, it was just very convenient to have a little community store, a little community gas station, maybe a laundromat. And so a lot of these stores were just that. They were a significant part, an essential part of these little commerce centers in these neighborhoods and little communities all over the city of Rocky Mount. Some of these, by the way, are not in Rocky Mount. Some of these were taken as, well, I don't guess how far, because there was some, I'm not even sure where they were taken. But we'll go ahead and jump into them. We'll go ahead and put the first one up. This is the AMP grocery store building on Marigold Street. And again, these were all taken in 1988. So, and of course, over the years, there was a number of different things in there. If you remember from a previous show, this store got damaged in 1954, when Hurricane Hazel come through. We showed a picture of the damage that took place when Hurricane Hazel come through. If you notice, on the very right-hand side of this picture, in the background, that is the gym at R.M. Wilson High School. When I was over there, on occasion during gym class, a couple of buddies and I would sneak out of gym class, walk across the street there, and go to the A&P and get ourselves a bag of chips and a drink or whatever, and then sneak back across the street back into the gym. And I don't want to say we got caught, but we weren't so fortunate one time and had to do a little after school work for the sake of going and getting a bag of chips and a soft drink during gym class. But anyway, all right, Lee, let's go to the next one if you would. This is actually referred to as Arlington Street Grocery Store. This is one of the ones that was actually labeled on the back of the picture as Arlington Street Grocery. And again, I'm not sure when this became a grocery store, how long it was, and some of these were, you know, two or three different named stores over the years. But in 1988, this one was still operating as Arlington Street Grocery Store. So, okay, Lee, let's go to the next one then. Many of you who live on this side of town will recognize this. Barnes Grocery Building, Grocery Store Building. You see there, Barnes Grocery and Market. On Meadowbrook Road, and this picture was taken in 1988. We got a call. Let's get this call. Hello, caller. You on the air?
All right. That little grocery store that was Arlington Street Grocery Store was belonged to Albert Boone's parents. It was Albert Boone just recently died. He was one of the people that founded Boone Hill, Allen, and Ricks. Go ahead. I didn't mean to interrupt your program.
That's quite all right. That's, anything like you could add like that, I appreciate you doing so. Thanks again.
Bye.
All right, buddy. We'll see you. Okay. Okay. All right. So, again, Barnes Grocery Store here, Meadowbrook Road. Picture taken 1988. All right, Lee, let's go to the next one. This is Bachelor's Grocery at Little Eisenberg. I remember this store very well. There used to be a little grill on the right-hand side of the store, and a little girl worked in there, and she made some of the best cheeseburgers and hot dogs. This was a regular stop of ours. As teenagers in high school, we'd stop here. That day, Little Eisenberg, where Halifax Road crosses Sunset Avenue. In fact, I used to be neighbors with the man who, I think his name was Jimmy Baxter, actually, the man who run this store, lived right in the street from us when I was a small child. Okay, Lee, let's go ahead then to the next one. And this is the Big Star Grocery Store on Tarbor Street. Down there, not too far from the main post office. Of course, it's empty now, been empty for a number of years. I don't know when the last time there was anything operating. I think it was a Colonial store there after it was Big Star, or vice versa. But, of course, empty now. And in 1988, we had two big stars in Rocky Mount. This one and the other one was at Tarrytown Mall. So Lee, if you would, let's bring up the next picture. And this next one is the big star store that was at Tarrytown Mall. And of course, in later years, there was a dollar store there. It too got flooded during Hurricane Floyd. I forgot what's in there. There's something in there, been in there since then. But anyway, this is at Tarrytown Mall. Now, of course, the Sam's Club Shopping Center is over in that same area. Okay, this next one is actually from Castalia. And this is Bobbitt's Store in Castalia. There you go. I'm not exactly sure where this was. It looks familiar to me. I've been to Castalia many times over the years. I can't quite place this, but I'm guessing it's probably right on the main drag going through Castalia there. I mean, that would make sense that it would, that's where it would be, but I don't remember this particular building, and probably rode by it a bunch of times over the years and just didn't remember it. The next one is actually was referred to as Burnett's Grocery. I skipped one. Bullock Farm Meats. Yep. Bullock Farm Meats. I don't know where this was, quite frankly. It reminds me of a couple of different stores. Maybe someone remembers this, remembers where it was. And I don't know that it was not in somehow associated with ZB Bullock Meats. It could have been. I just don't know, quite frankly. I don't know where this building was, but it was one of the ones that was identified on the back, and of course, the names on the front of the building there too. Okay, now only the next one, Burnett's Grocery Store, and this was on Holly Street. And obviously it's an old building there, and it's in 1988 when this picture was taken, it was obviously empty, boarded up, and no longer anything there. This is another one that I'm not quite sure, it may not even be there now. It's been obviously 34 years ago that this picture was taken. And whoever was taking the pictures was driving a Cadillac, because I see the hood of this Cadillac in several of these pictures. But they would pull up to an intersection or pull up in front of a store, snap a picture, and then ride on to the next one. And so a good many of these, I actually edited out the hood of the Cadillac, but I didn't do it on this one, obviously. But this again, this is on Holly Street. It was referred to on the back of the picture as Burnett's Grocery. Okay, Lee, let's go to the next one then. And this next one is C. Roy Williford Store. Oh, we got a call. Let's get this call. Hello, caller. You on the air?
Randy.
Yes, sir.
Hey, man. This is Bobby.
Yeah, man.
That Bullock Farm Meats is at Tarb Highway and Springfield Road.
Which one? Bullock Meats?
Yeah. The Bullock's of Meats. Because when I was stationed down the road, Station 5, that's where we'd go get our groceries.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So it's Tarbor Highway and Springfield Road?
Springfield.
Springfield, uh-huh. Okay, I know exactly what you're talking about. I didn't realize that was... Okay, I got you now. All right, buddy, appreciate it.
Okay.
All right, we'll see you.
All right, bye.
Bye-bye. Okay, so Lee, I tell you what, let's go to then C. Roy Williford was number... Okay, let's go to the next one is Cap's Grocery on Falls Road. In 88, it was... obviously Falls Road Supermarket. When I was a kid, it was Cap's Grocery. And we've talked about this in the past too. There was actually two grocery stores side by side in this building here operating at the same time up through, golly, probably the 1950s, I think it was. By the time I came along, this used to be one of my stops on the way to school. In fact, I went to school, elementary school over at Wilkerson Elementary School, and lived on Columbia Avenue. We'd walk from Columbia Avenue up to Ridge Street, walk down Ridge Street, stop at Cap's and get us either an apple or an orange or a snack, and then walk across Falls Road and walk up to Peachtree Street and turn left and then walk down to Wilkerson School. And made that jump many, many times before we finally moved from Columbia Avenue over to Inglewood in 1967. Okay, Lee, so let's go ahead then to the next one. We'll try to get as many as we can before we run out of time. This next one is actually, I found this after I found the picture, and I got them reversed. But anyway, you see the location there was 1308 Cokey Road, and David Hill Grocery was the name of the business. And now if you would, Lee, go ahead and put up the picture that corresponds to that ad, and that's it right there. This is another one that I don't recall. I can't say I remember this store. I'm sure it was in 1986, I was or 88, I mean, I was around Rocky Mountain, so I may have ridden past it, but I can't say I remember it. I do remember there being a couple stores as you're headed out of Cokie Road, leaving Rocky Mountain, headed east. Could have been on the right-hand side, there was a couple stores out there. And of course, Nugent's Grocery, everyone remembers Nugent's Grocery on the left-hand side on Cokie Road. But this is one I did not remember here. So anyway, okay, Lee, so go ahead to the next one. And this is one I did remember. This was Earl Gay's Grocery. And in later years, I understand that, I don't know if it was Earl Gay's son or brother or someone else took it over, and it became Ray Gay's Meats. And I remember going out here and taking deer meat and have it turn into sausage, and I understand a lot of folks took different types of meat out there, and this was back when you could do that. Now, of course, they won't let you do that now, I don't think. Probably some individuals do it, but as a business, it's kind of frowned upon now, but anyway. All right, and then the next one, Lee, this is, and again, these are all from 1988, at least when the picture was taken. On the back of this picture, it said Eason's Store Building with a question mark. And that's all it had on the back. In 1988, it was obviously empty, so it's hard to tell from this picture. There was no sign, obviously, nothing to give you any clues unless you just happen to recognize the building. Eason's Store sounds vaguely familiar to me, but as far as where it was, I haven't a clue, so I won't guess. The next picture, however, I remember very well and spent a many happy hour inside Bobby Mears' Englewood Supermarket. You know, this is obviously the corner of Sunset Avenue and Forest Hill Avenue. CVS Drugstore is there now. But when I was a kid, this was not only a bus stop every morning. This is where we'd catch the bus. We would go in here, Bobby's, and, you know, my parents shopped there. We'd shop there for groceries, and we would also get snacks there. I was in this store almost daily for several years when I was growing up, and I thought a lot of Bobby Mears. He was a fine fella, and there was a lot of good folks who worked with Bobby at this store here. And it was a shame when he passed away. Of course, he sold the store before he passed away. But anyway, we're almost out of time, but I think we got two more. Let's try to get these real quick. Food Line at at Edgecombe Shopping Center. This store, I think the building is still there. I don't think it's Food Line anymore. I think it's something else now. And then lastly, there is the former ZB Bullock Meats building on Planter Street. Not sure what was in it after ZB Bullock had it, but in the 1930s and 40s, when Mr. ZB Bullock had his meat company, it was located on Planter Street in this building right here. So, well, folks, that's going to do it for us tonight. We've run slam out of time. Lee, bring it back to me, and we'll wrap things up. Folks, I want to thank you so much for watching, and thank you for calling in and sharing your memories with us. Next week, I've got a bunch more of these, and like I said, they're broken into several categories, so we'll kind of try to cover all the bases over the next 2, 3, 4 weeks, because there's some really neat pictures of restaurants. There's businesses, a lot of buildings. They were all taken in 1988, but a lot of history there still. So thanks for joining us. Have a great week. Take care of yourselves and be kind to one another. We'll see you next week with more Way Back Wins. Good night.
I'm Daniel Moss, owner of Cornerstone Funeral Home, and I'd like to invite you and your family to give our family an opportunity to serve you in your time of need. And we offer a full line of funeral services, everything from visitations to graveside services to cremations on site with a live crematory, as well as a banquet hall to meet the catering needs of our families that we serve. We offer catering service. We offer refreshments prior to visitations and services of our family. And we want to invite you to come and experience the difference here at Cornerstone Funeral Home.
Hello, my name is Gus Tullis of Gus Tullis Insurance, and I've been helping people with their insurance needs for well over 20 years. If you're turning 65 or you're currently on Medicare, I can help you make the best decision for the Medicare plan that will suit your needs. Don't wait. Call me today. I'll answer any question you have. 252-937-6913. Looking forward to hearing from you.
When faced with special care needs for elderly or disabled loved ones, families want compassionate, comforting care. That's Tender Touch Home Care Services' goal, providing the level of care we would expect for our own. With over 10 years of home care excellence, Tender Touch provides an array of services that keeps your loved one at home. From personal care, light housekeeping, errands, and meal preparation, to our private duty care program, which combines all of our home care offerings in one package.
Tender Touch Home Care Services, where your needs are our concern.